get started, all of the family that said, I don't know, they said, well, you just got lucky. And you know what? We started to believe that. Well, we must have just got lucky, right? But the next month after that, we earned a little over $4,000. You know, we had more customers. We had more distributors where we had some wholesale. We had some royalties coming in. We had all of the types of business coming in, not just one stream, not just retail, and not just wholesale, but we had royalties too. We had everything, okay? They didn't have production bonus back then. Go figure, right? So, but we were excited, and so I had made up my mind. I just hated my boss. I loved interior design, but I just didn't like him as a person because he wasn't very kind. He was the guy that his office was at the very end of the hallway. This is the same guy that told me, don't put your check in the bank. The same man, right? And he would sit there, when you would come in to work, he would sit there and look at his big watch. And it wasn't a Rolex, okay? It was a big Timex. He'd look at his watch. He'd look at what time you were walking in. And I would think, really? You know, and then if I stayed later than 5 o'clock, he wasn't looking at his watch, saying, oh, you know, she's staying later. So he was just kind of a harsh person. So I just made up my mind after about the third, fourth month, I was like, that's it, I'm going to just do Herbalife. I've got nothing to lose. I'm young. If this doesn't work out, I'll do something else, right? And so I came in to tell him. I said, listen, his name was Ray. I said, Ray, I just want to tell you that, you know, I really appreciate you. I appreciate the opportunity I've had here. But this is going to be my last day. I have another job I'm going to be doing. He goes, oh, what is that? And I said, well, I'm going to be doing Herbalife, the Herbalife business, health and nutrition, helping people to get healthy and helping them with their financial future. I'm really excited about changing people's lives. He goes, the only life that's going to change is yours. You'll be begging for your job again. I said, no, I'm not going to do that. And I said, I'll see you later. He said, well, you're going to be sorry. But the only thing I'm sorry about is that it took me 30 days too long. I should have said goodbye earlier, right? I was happy I left that job. I was happy until I got home that day. Because I hadn't exactly told John I was going to quit my job. And so, when he got home, I was already home, and I said, John, I need to talk to you about something. He said, well, I need to talk to you about something. I said, oh, what's that? He goes, I quit my job. I said, I did too. I said, oh my God, what are we going to do? So, we called Jim back. Jim, we quit our jobs. Oh my gosh, what are we going to do? We don't know what to do. We don't know how to do this. We quit our job and we didn't. He goes, just do all day what you did part time. No wonder he was number one, right? Smart. Simple. Clear. So we were like, oh, I can't believe we're scared. We quit. He goes, what took you so long? Okay, well, here we are. So we got going and we had really fast success. And we were very lucky at the time period we were in, all the things going on. But at the same time, you know, we really had not learned our lesson about things. You know, the income came pretty fast, and so we just spent it. Just as fast as it came in, we were spending it, living large. Right? Yeah. Not really, because because then in 1985, Herbalife had some challenges in America with the FDA. And of course, you know, there was no internet then. There was no social media or unsocial media. There was no Twitter, Twitter, none of it, okay? There was, a new TV program that had just come on who had this crazy idea of 24-hour news, and they loved sensational stuff called CNN. And CNN thought, well, this is exciting. This company called Herbalife has got some problem with the FDA. We're going to put it on the news. They did. All over the news. It was so terrible. And my parents called and said, please don't do that Herbalife business. It's, you know, it's no good. You're involved with something that is we don't think is right. We're scared for you. You could be harming people. And, you know, of course, there was nothing wrong with the products at all. And 18 months later, that got proven right, but unfortunately, CNN was on to other stories, and there was no need to tell the true story. So what happened was our business collapsed. We were making a lot of money. All of a sudden, we were making just a little bit of money, but our bills were still up here now because we were living large. So we actually lost our home to foreclosure to the bank. It's probably one of the most humiliating things I've had happen in my life, where the bank takes your house and you kind of like move out in the middle of the night and your neighbors are wondering what's going on. It's terrible. We moved out, moved to Austin, worked in Austin, worked hard to try to rebuild. John, he didn't start back in Herbalife. He went and sold manufactured housing, mobile homes. He did that till I could get enough stuff going with Herbalife. I stayed with it, thank God, and got enough going where then he came back and joined me after 4 months. And then from Austin, we started working in Colorado, ended up moving to Colorado, and sort of started a new life with our Herbalife business in a little tiny rented house, having three other distributors living in the house with us, and three dogs and two cats. And I was the only woman. So these were our team, okay, our guys, our literally guys, our guys, came and lived with us. And just to sort of give you an idea about how serious things were for us at that point, in order to pay the bills, in order to pay the electric bill, in order to pay the gas bill, any bills, okay, the bill would come in the mail, I would write the check, put it in the envelope, close the envelope, and you know where you put the stamp on it? I would put the date that bill was due and how much money where the stamp was. And then I would go and I would sell enough products to customers to cover how much that bill was, put in that money in the bank, and when I knew I had that money in the bank, I'd then put the stamp on and mail the bill. So, I mean, I wasn't always this glamorous, right? Then for us, sort of like a real breakthrough happened. And that was that Mexico was going to open. And we had a lot of friends in Mexico. We knew a lot of people. And remember the story about the neighbor that had dropped out? Five people down was one other person who said, hey, I want to go with you if you're going to go to Mexico. We said, fine. That was Jan and Zane Miller. And so Jan and Zane and John and I, we rented a little house in Mexico City. Didn't speak any Spanish. And we built all of our business in Mexico at that point. And from cab drivers to anybody that walked. I could still, to this very day, the place where we had rented to do our little opportunity meetings, I could still see it in my mind. I could still give you the presentation in Spanish, because I was the person, when they called, I was the person that would speak, and I had it all phonetically written out of where they needed to go, who they needed to meet, and I'm sorry that all their questions would be answered at the appointment. And so, I mean, we did that again and again, then we did that in Guadalajara, and then we moved on from Guadalajara to Veracruz and on to Monterrey. So literally I lived all over Mexico, and then that took us into Spain, into Bilbao. And we started in Europe in Bilbao when Spain opened, and then went up to Bordeaux in France and got people going there. And then what's going to be exciting for me, this is before Italy opened, was going to be mine and John's 10-year anniversary. But this is a great story. I was so excited. He said, "Susan, I've been working in Germany." And he said, "Listen," he says, "I'm going to fly you to Germany, and we're going to have a wonderful 10-year anniversary." I was like, "Oh, okay, great, great." So get on the plane, go to Germany, get off the plane. There's no John. Instead, it's one of our distributors. I don't want to say his name. It's one of our distributors. And I said, "Where's John?" "Well, I need you to come with us. We had a little bit of a challenge." I said, "What's that?" "And, well, how much money do you have?" "Some." "Why?" "Well, it was against the law to put flyers out in a certain part of Germany, and they did, and they're all in jail, and they need you to come help them right now." Okay. That was a shock. You need to check the local laws. You cannot do flyers in certain parts of Germany. Okay? Golly. So anyway, I was expecting to be staying at the fancy Bayerischerhof Hotel in Munich. I was not staying there. He had a little hotel in a little town outside of Nuremberg, and he was all excited because it was, you know, up on the top floor, and there was like a suite. So it had a living room in one part, it had the bedroom in the other part. Little did I know, the living room part was the opportunity meeting part. Every day, five times a day. And at night, that's where the distributors slept. That's right, our team was still there with us for the 10-year anniversary. It just, you know, my life is just so crazy. It keeps going. Then we went from there into Italy, into Torino, was where we started 25 years ago. And that was beyond exciting, amazing. Amazing people, amazing everything, and then from Torino into Bologna and Rimini and Rome and all over. I mean, just everywhere. Our business sort of just took us everywhere. And in between this, we had some children. Okay, we had my twins, and that was a great moment and also a very frightening moment. You know, I don't know if you guys know. Of course, my kids, they're 27 now. And, you know, you saw on the picture the other day at the cell phone, the picture of my kids. They're healthy and wonderful and everything is good. But, you know, they were born 10 weeks early. 10 weeks early. And so they had to be in the hospital for 7 weeks. And so when they were born, I don't know what this is in kilograms or however you weigh everything here, but they only weighed, my son weighed 1 pound, 12 ounces, and my daughter weighed 1 pound, 10 ounces. about this big. And so it was very frightening, that came early because I couldn't get any larger. I had never had a baby before, so, there was no more room in the inn. I was, as big as I could get. The inn was totally, totally full, okay? So, but, I'm just so grateful to Herbalife because if there hadn't been Herbalife in my life, first of all, I was at the healthiest place in my life I could have ever been, and my kids were born when they're not super healthy. They just needed to gain weight, and the doctor couldn't even believe that. There was nothing wrong with anything with them. They just needed to gain weight. And the doctor said, I don't know what you've been doing, but whatever you've been doing, what a blessing it is because your children are healthy. And so I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful that, yes. Grateful for so many things, I'm grateful that I had the ability to have the health insurance and stuff because, it's not automatic in America. You have to pay for it. So, all of these things. But, although my life was sounding pretty good, it had some bumps in the road too, probably one of the toughest things is I got a phone call one day, and it was a Sunday, and it was from somebody at the company, and they said, what are you doing? And I said, what do you mean? Well, they said, what are you doing right now? And I said, it's Sunday. We've just gotten back from church, and I'm cooking Sunday dinner. Why? And they said, Mark Hughes has passed away. And I was like, what? And they said, Mark Hughes has passed away. And I couldn't believe it. I almost dropped the phone, and John and I were devastated. And it was horrible. We lost our friend, our mentor, the founder of the company. The company was uncertain. What are we going to do? Were we going to go forward without Mark Hughes? Because Mark Hughes was everything. And we flew to Los Angeles. And it was such a sad time. The funeral was so terrible. So very sad. Red roses everywhere. obviously all of the Chairman's Club. I don't know what you think about the Chairman's Club. I mean, you know, if you're 20, 30K, if you're 10K, if you're a president's team, a millionaire, a 7.5, or a new person, I don't know what your impression is of the Chairman's Club. I think some people think, oh, people want to be on the Chairman's Club so they can, you know, go and, you know, be this celebrity on stage or something like that. Really, it's not anything like that. I just remember when there we were gathered, there were about 10 of us, maybe 11, I don't know, I have to think of the numbers back then. But this was in the year 2000, and we had to go out and be the voice of Mark Hughes. And I'm going to just tell you, it was the most frightening thing I've ever done in my life, because I never had to do that. All I ever had to do before was be Susan Peterson, worrying about Susan Peterson's distributorship. I never had to really think about everybody else's distributorship. Now, all of a sudden, all of the Chairman's Club, we had to be the voice of Mark Hughes, we had to represent the company, we needed to go and be in the big events and stuff to be representing the distributorships of the company, the voice of Mark Hughes, and really had to put a lot of our businesses on the side. So it was a very interesting change to have to go through. The next thing is, you know, my mentor at that time that I'd had, who was a distributor, he passed away right very closely afterwards, several years later, and that was Bill Heron, and that was devastating for me personally, because anytime I had a question about anything in life, anything in business, anything, I would pick up the phone and call Bill, and he was always there for me, and he would always be honest, and he would tell me the hard words when I needed to hear the hard words. He would tell me the soft ones when I needed to hear the soft ones, and that was devastating for me. For him to pass away. And then right in the same year, I experienced something else. I experienced divorce. You know, I experienced being a single mom, taking care of my kids without having a partner there with you. I really understood what it was like when you got somebody started in the business that was a single parent. And I'm going to tell you that I am ashamed of how I thought about people before I had walked that path myself. I used to think that if they were a single parent, they needed to make more time and do this and do that and do this and do that so they could do more for taking care of their kids, instead of realizing their time was so limited and so difficult. And the road that they had to walk was a very hard road. Interesting thing about the journey for me is the highs and the lows and the lessons from each. Interesting, when you're having wonderful things happen, you don't really think about what's this, what's that. You know, you're just experiencing and you're not looking for the lessons coming from what am I doing right, what is good, what do I need to do more of, and when things are not good, that's when you sort of have this introspective look. I would just tell you that I've gone through all kinds of things. You know, and the hard thing is like if you are divorced, can you imagine being divorced and making the decision to still be in business with your ex-spouse? This is one thing I would say. You know, John and I, we did not want our distributors to have to choose who they were going to be loyal to or love. And so we made the decision. We were really one of the first couples in our life that didn't divorce and have two separate distributorships. We just kept the one. And I'm so glad that we did, because it was very healing. It was very healing for all of our team. And in the long run, it was healing for John and I, because in the long run, although we led different lives, we became friends again, laughing again about things that had happened and things that had gone on, and when so-and-so did this and when so-and-so did that. Do you remember at so-and-so's wedding what happened and how they got sick over here and, you know, all these things? So we had a lot of laughs. We had it was a very unique relationship where we were very good friends. And in 2013, we were at Paris for the honors, and we were all sitting at the same table, John and myself, our kids, some of our friends. And it was such an honor because we had been the number two distributorship for several years in a row. Our downline was always number one. And either the Varellas or Raquel, one of them, okay? We were so lucky that at Paris, we were given the opportunity to be given the number one distributorship again, and that was the last time I saw John. Because a few months later, he passed away. So far, that's been the hardest thing I've ever had to deal with in my life. You know, I just keep putting one foot in front of the other. I keep going to work every day. I go to my office Monday through Friday, 9 to 4:30. Boring. Every day. And I try to take care of challenges around the world. Be there for the people that need me. Try to do the right thing best I can. So I guess if I have a message for anybody in my story, you know, these are things that happen in life. Just everybody has challenges. Everybody has sadness, and, you know, hopefully not everybody has a divorce. And hopefully everybody is not going to have to experience the different degrees of death. But we all have to experience these things, different things. And if it's not us, it's somebody we love. So I learned to be maybe a little kinder, a little more thoughtful in my prayers every night, thinking of everybody, making sure I tell people I love them. And it's not just a job. It really is a journey that we're on. And we have such an amazing opportunity to not just be ordinary, but to be extraordinary in this world where we can make a difference. We can help people with their health. We can help people with their struggles. You know, everybody struggles. We can be the happy, shining light of optimism. We can be the chance that they need to take the next step in life. You just can't imagine, every single person in this room, how impactful you are. Every one of you is impacting 10, 20, 30, 100 people all the time. And sometimes it's people you don't even know. And just a kind word or a nice smile or a nice touch, what a difference that can make in their life. I just know that I was so lucky. I learned how to do this business from remarkable people, from Mark Hughes and Jim Rohn, and even Jim, my sponsor, who left. He taught me a lot of disciplines that I have to be grateful for, and I'm grateful that he got us started in the business, even though he left to start another company that failed. But I would just tell you that this has been an incredible journey. I hope I have many years more to experience my life journey and to deepen friendships with you and to learn more about you. You know, probably the most important thing you can do is not only tell your story, but listen to other people's stories. Because that's the difference. That's what makes us human beings and can make us better, stronger, more caring. Being able to help the person to become what they want to be and celebrate as they achieve. You know, I have to tell you, I'm sad John isn't here, and I'm sad he's not going to be there for our daughter's wedding. But I'm excited about our daughter's wedding. This is a part of my journey I can hardly wait for in 90 days. 90 days. I just want to invite everybody to really, you know, turn to the person next to you, tell them you love them, tell them that they matter, tell them that you're grateful that you're a part of their life and they're a part of yours, because you just don't know. You don't know what's next. Life is unpredictable. But you know what? I mean, our friendships and our business, not just in our organization, but in other organizations, in our Herbalife business, they are life-sustaining. And I don't know where I'd be if I didn't have my friends. I don't know where I'd be if I didn't have my family. And I don't know where I'd be if I hadn't had the opportunity to meet you guys. I love you guys so much, and I just pray the very best for each and every one of you, and that God bless your business. Amen. That didn't get started, all of the family that said, I don't know, they said, well, you just got lucky. And you know what? We started to believe that. Well, we must have just got lucky, right? But the next month after that, we earned a little over $4,000. You know, we had more customers. We had more distributors where we had some wholesale. We had some royalties coming in. We had all of the types of business coming in, not just one stream, not just retail, and not just wholesale. But we had royalties too. We had everything. Okay, they didn't have production bonus back then. Go figure, right? So, but we were excited, and so I had made up my mind. I just hated my boss. I loved interior design, but I just didn't like him as a person because he wasn't very kind. He was the guy that his office was at the very end of the hallway. This is the same guy that told me, don't put your check.